Hello, my name is Ben, and I would like to show you a game that I've been working on. I feel like I have a history of starting a lot of games and not necessarily finishing them. I have more abandoned projects than I can count, and I get the feeling that that's true for a lot of people, regardless of the kind of things they make, if it's stories they write or things they draw. You end up with a lot of things you just don't finish for one way or another. Or at least that's my experience. Maybe me and the couple other people I know are exceptions. But anyway, I feel that the game, one of the games that I have had the most success with was a web browser-based game called SciPets. And I think that the reason that that was so successful is that I was immediately able to get feedback. Initially I was working on it with my friends in college, and they, I showed it to them and they said, "Oh, implement this, implement that. It would be great if the pets could do this or that." And then once I had forums, then that just continued with people from an increasing, soon I had people from Australia and Canada and other English-speaking parts of the world playing this game, and they got excited about it and I got excited about it, which made me want to work on it more. So it was a really good cycle. This is not a web game. This is something that you'll download for your computer or hopefully for mobile devices. I'm using a library that makes coding for mobile devices easy, so I'm hoping to do both. But without a website and something playable for people to be able to start giving me feedback on, and I don't have, in college you just all your friends live nearby. It's really easy and trivial to show off things to friends. It's just not the same environment. I feel like I don't get that same feedback. So I'm hoping to fix that for this game by recording this video and putting it on YouTube, and hopefully people will see it. I'll link from it on Facebook and everywhere else I know how, and hopefully get some people saying, "Oh, it would be awesome if there was this," or, "Oh, I hope you don't do that," or whatever. Any sorts of ideas, and then I'll release another video after I've made some changes, and we can see what people think and create that sort of cycle where I maintain interest and make something cool for other people. So let me just show you what the game has. There is not a lot, as I've mentioned, but I can show you what there is. So this game is a god game based on things like Dwarf Fortress or Populous, although I never played Populous, unfortunately. Maybe I should do that as research. But it is a god game, and you give people orders, and similar to Dwarf Fortress or maybe Space Base DF9, which I haven't played, but I've been keeping up the development. You'll be able to tell people, you're allowed to cut trees or you're not allowed to, and they kind of get initial parameters. Let's see how many lumberjacks we have here. At least three, apparently. If the So let me tell you about these little check boxes or these little arrows. If it's green, that means someone is assigned to the order. If it's yellow, that means that the job has been set, but no one has taken it yet. So since they all turned green immediately, we must have at least three people willing to do lumberjacking jobs. But I've gotten a little ahead of myself. The other game that this is based on is Oregon Trail. And Oregon Trail is a game I loved a lot as a kid. I think a lot of people did. It was one of those games that they let you play in elementary school, at least when I was little. And we all wondered why, because it was a game, but you don't ask, because you get to play a game. It's awesome, right? And the reason I came to Oregon Trail was really two reasons. The first is that it was a fun game that I liked a lot as a kid. It had a lot of personality. You would name the characters after your friends, and when their arm broke, you would call across the lab and say, "Abby, your arm broke," or "You've got, I don't know what diseases they had," but it was fun to kind of have that personality to it. But another reason I came to it was a more practical sort of reason, and that I wanted to be able to make this game quickly and easily, because the harder it is initially, the less likely it is that I'll make a lot of progress. And pathfinding was a spot where I thought I would have a lot of trouble. I have done a little bit of pathfinding for other games, but a lot of the games I've made haven't had a lot of pathfinding or much artificial intelligence, really. So I didn't want to create a game where that was going to be a really hard thing for me to do. And two-dimensional, like Oregon Trail, the original Oregon Trail, the pathfinding is easy. You either go left or you go right, which is closer. It's trivial by comparison. It looks very two-dimensional, but it's in fact one-dimensional. You can go left or right. It's just a line. The height here is purely cosmetic. They don't slow down to go up hills or anything like that. So anyway, that's why I did Oregon Trail. And I mean, as a god game, I have just been interested in those. I mean, they've been popular recently, and they've been popular because people like them. I like them, so I wanted to make one myself. And I thought a 2D game would be kind of interesting as well for a god game, because I don't think I've seen one of those. I'm sure one exists somewhere, but I haven't seen it. So I thought it would be interesting to try that out and see how it goes. Maybe there's a reason you don't see them. Maybe they turn out to not be very successful, but I think it can be a fun game. So let me show you. I showed you that they can cut down trees. There's only really one other thing they can do, and that is to collect this wood. Right now, you can see I'm assigning the orders myself, but we would love if they kind of did it automatically. It seems kind of silly to have to tell them to pick up the wood. And there you saw briefly some yellow arrows. Whoops. We can see I selected an order that doesn't exist. You saw briefly the arrows were yellow, which means that there isn't a worker assigned, as I mentioned. And right now they're not very good about picking jobs. You know, it's possible that someone will, like, suppose you've got two trees, or just one tree, and two lumberjacks, and you say, tree, I want you to be cut down. It won't necessarily pick the nearest lumberjack to cut the tree. It might be a lumberjack on the other side of the world. And that's because the jobs don't think about getting workers. The workers think about getting jobs, if that makes sense. So when the game steps through every millisecond to think, what does each person want to do? A person decides, oh, I want to take a job. And so it's just whichever person happens to first claim the job is the one that gets it, and even though he might be the worst person in terms of distance to do it. So that's something that's going to have to be fixed. But even before that, there's a lot of things that we need. Cutting down wood and collecting it is not the most interesting game. We would like them to be able to build new buildings, to fish, to grow food, and to eat. And, you know, stay alive. Hunting animals, too. There might be the possibility to get hurt, so we'll need some kind of medicine. Here we can see them dropping off the logs in their covered wagon. So speaking about eating and getting hurt, let's talk about some of the things that might happen in the future of the game. So we can look at these people and see how they're feeling. I'm hoping to find someone who doesn't have this question line. That's just me being lazy and not having all the text in. Well, maybe I won't. My laziness will. I'm not going to get away with it. So here are their needs. I'm basing their behavior on Maslow's hierarchy of needs, which is something I've used for CyPets, the game I mentioned before. It was that's what I used to model their behavior. It's a theory developed by a psychologist. I don't remember when anymore. It's been a long time since I first learned about it, like high school, I think. But Maslow says there's a little pyramid. He has it as a pyramid, but it's a hierarchy of needs. And on the bottom are needs of the body, such as sleep and food. Or I should say food and then sleep. Wait, no, I'm getting everything backwards. Don't worry about it. So sleep and food. And then assuming those things are met, then you worry about your safety. And assuming all those things are met, then you worry about how loved you feel, and not just romantic, but, you know, having friends. And then assuming all those are met, then you will worry about your self-esteem. And here he says he's happy. Everyone starts off with pretty good stats. And so the key is that assuming everything else is met, then you worry. That's sort of the key of Maslow's hierarchy. For example, if you are feeling very hungry, then Maslow says you won't worry about your own safety. You won't worry about having, you know, being on good terms with your friends. If you're really a starving individual, those things aren't important. What's important is getting food. And that seems maybe obvious because you need food to live, but he also says if you're not feeling safe, then you won't worry about friends or self-esteem. And, you know, it starts to get a little more interesting in that area, but also kind of makes sense if you think about, you know, maybe these guys are getting attacked by bears in the woods, or maybe it's just raining on them or snowing and they're cold. You know, they will want to get to a place where they feel safe. You don't have time to chat with friends when you're being mauled by a bear. Things like that. So there are certainly places where you can debate how well or how accurate this is for a real human. You know, real humans are capable of setting aside their own needs for the sake of others or for the sake of their beliefs. But I think for a game, it works really well. It worked really well for CyPets. It gives them a basic sort of model of behavior that seems reasonable. You know, it's not surprising to you when they need food rather than friendship or something. So I'm hoping to use that again here, and I don't think that'll be that hard. And right now, these needs are going down. I think we'd have to wait a few minutes to see that, so you won't be able to see that. But they'll get more tired and more hungry, and right now they don't have a way to fix that. There's no food in the game, just wood. You can't really eat wood. And they don't pass out or anything. So on the other hand, they don't die right now, so all their needs will go in the red, and it'll be fine. In the red, and that's terminology I picked up from working on SciPets, because the colors it red, and I'll probably do the same thing here. When a need is not met. So, well, in the red is a term for anything, you know, money. Anyway, this is what we've got for the game so far. Some randomly generated colonists, some randomly generated enormous terrain. I could scroll for a long time, we won't see the end of it. It does not go on forever, but it is very large. And that's it. So, I'm hoping to get more feedback from you guys. Here's some water. By the way, they walk on water right now. But anyway, I'm hoping to get some feedback from anyone who happens to watch this. If, you know, if this seems like an interesting project to you, if this seems like a game, you know, I can't say that you would want to play because there's not much to do right now, but you think it has the potential to be something that you would really enjoy. Definitely, you know, give me some feedback. Tell me this is what I want, this is what I don't want. And let's get that feedback loop going of excitement and development, and that would be great. So thanks for watching, and again, leave your comments, and hopefully I'll have another video again soon.